The United Nations General Assembly was the scene of a celebration in 2015, when 193 member countries adopted the Sustainable Development Goals, a unanimous commitment to end poverty, fight inequality, and tackle climate change.
We need action from everyone, everywhere. 17 Sustainable Development Goals are our guide. They are a to-do list for people and planet, and the blueprint for success.
The SDGs are an agenda to balance human prosperity with protecting the planet.
Imagine there's no countries.
UNICEF Goodwill Ambassador Shakira asked global leaders to imagine a world where we achieve the goals by 2030. While fellow UNICEF Goodwill Ambassador Angelique Kidjo underscored a focus on Africa and developing countries. But the universal agenda is important to all nations, as leaders from developed countries also pledged to make the goals a reality.
Poverty, growing inequality exists in all of our nations, and all of our nations have work to do, and that includes here in the United States. And that's why today I am committing the United States to achieving the Sustainable Development Goals.
The Sustainable Development Goals build on the success of another 15-year plan. Created in the year 2000, the Millennium Development Goals sunset at the end of 2015. The MDGs halved extreme poverty, achieved equal primary education for girls and boys, and dropped HIV infection by 40%, among many successes. The SDGs go beyond the MDGs by improving the lives of everyone, everywhere, and create a better world for future generations.
Today, we are 193 young people representing billions more.
The youngest Nobel Peace Laureate, Malala, calls on world leaders to keep their promise to every child.
Each lantern we hold represents the hope we have for our future because of the commitments you have made to the global goals.
And Pope Francis advised world leaders to put humanity and the environment over politics.
Los gobernantes han de hacer todo lo posible a fin de que todos puedan tener la mínima base material y espiritual para ejercer su dignidad y para formar y mantener una familia.
193 nations unanimously committed to the Sustainable Development Goals.
It is so decided.
But the journey starts here. Now's the time to take global action for local results and move our people and planet towards a sustainable future.
Thank you very much. We're going to leave the floor to Ricardo Arzuaga.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you for joining us tonight. With that context in mind, it is indeed a pleasure to have so many distinguished guests with us tonight in this activity pertaining the SDGs in academia. My name is Ricardo Arzuaga. I'm the Executive Director of the Puerto Rico Chapter of the United Nations Association of the United States. And it's indeed an honor now to pass the microphone to our host and moderator, Mr. Luis Alberto Ferrer Rangel, Chief Social Innovation Officer at GFR.
Thank you, Ricardo. Again, a pleasure to be here moderating this very important dialogue, and also very honored to be here to have as guests, not only Dr. Professor Jeffrey Sachs, but also the women and men that in Puerto Rico are responsible to keep a higher education going during the earthquakes, during the pandemic, and during the hurricane. Very pleased to be here, and I'm going to pass the baton to Jorge Gonzalez.
Well, good evening. Let me. Good evening. I'm the president of the board, and one of the things I've learned in life is to not say very much when there's so many people that can say things much better than me. So my role is just to thank you very much, as Ricardo was saying, for joining us, and we know you will all learn, and based on this, we will all work together to attain our goals. Thank you. Have a good evening. We'll be with you.
Thank you, Jorge. He's the board of president of the board of directors of the UNA USA Foundation. And lastly, I'm going to welcome the Secretary of State, Larry Selhammer, who's going to give us a welcoming remarks from the government perspective. He's a strong advocate of sustainability and resilience, and we're very happy to have him on board with all the challenges that that implies. So please, Secretary of State. And I believe he's there, but we cannot hear you, Secretary of State, or see you. Maybe our friends from the control room can help us.
Here we go. Am I on this mic right now?
You are on mic, sir. We cannot see you yet, but we can hear you.
Okay. How about now?
Now we can see you and hear you.
Here we go.
Welcome.
Thank you. Well, my greetings to all the participants in this conservatory, in which the main subject is Sustainable Development Goals for 2030, as established by the United Nations Organization. I appreciate the invitation made by our moderator and organizer of this event, Mr. Luis Alberto Ferre, in a collaborative effort between the Social Innovation Division of GFR and the chapter of Puerto Rico with the United Nations Association of the USA. As well, my recognition and appreciation to Professor Jeffrey Sachs, Executive Director for the Center of Sustainable Development Program at Columbia University. As you know, the United Nations created a set of 17 distinct but correlated goals to guide global development targeted at year 2030. Although each of the 17 goals might have a different or unique strategy, I firmly believe that various, not to say many, have a common denominator. That is global warming and climate change. As of 1988, through the initiative of the United Nations, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change was created, composed by over 100 countries all over the world, and with the designation and participation of their best scientists. By 2013, 25 years from the initial date of the IPCC, a determination and resolution was issued indicating that global warming dominant cause was produced by human influence. The scientific data obtained from numerous studies establishes astonishing results. For example, number one, Earth temperature has risen 1.27 degrees Fahrenheit or 0.85 degrees Celsius in the past 40 years. It took 5,000 years before to account for this temperature raise. Second astonishing result is that carbon dioxide emissions, one of the main producers of greenhouse gas effects and global warming, is at this particular moment 400 parts per million. Last time it surpassed 400 parts per million, it was million years ago. Therefore, it is not a perception or interpretation on global warming. It is a scientific issue. By 2030, if huge changes are not implemented, damages on our environment are going to be monumental, affecting our quality of life. The main goal across the world is to promote measures that can maintain below a rise of 2 degrees centigrade by 2050, our Earth temperature in comparison with the industrial era. So if we do not attend this effectively, some, maybe many, probably most of the SDG will not be achieved, such as good health, clean water, clean energy, economic growth, industry, innovation, and infrastructure. Also sustainable cities, life below water, and life on land. Now I would like to share something that we're doing here in Puerto Rico. We have taken strong and aggressive steps towards implementation of public policy that will result in reducing the effects on global warming. Under Act 17 of 2019, the Puerto Rico Energy Public Policy was created. Among many objectives, I would like to pinpoint the renewable energy portfolio, which seeks a 40% renewable energy portfolio for 2025, 60% for 2040, and 100% for 2050. Also, under Act 33, we established the public policy regarding climate change and plans for mitigation, adaptation, and resilience. Although Puerto Rico is a small contributor in comparison to the rest of the world, we must be proactive and lead other countries. As a matter of fact, the organization German Watch in 2018 pointed Puerto Rico as the first and most vulnerable jurisdiction by consequences of global warming or climate change. In different scientific reports and studies, the adverse consequences of climate change lead to sea level rise, increase on Earth temperature, drastic changes in precipitation, acidification at seawater, effects on health, on the economy, on the infrastructure, in atmospheric events, and in our ecosystems. Each of them affecting our life quality. And I understand, and I take this opportunity to go directly to our education system, our universities and colleges, which are fundamental to establish the foundation to begin our efforts. The synthesis report of 2012 by the IPCC describes perfectly the urgent action that worldwide must be taken. It states, and I quote, cut carbon pollution sharply, starting now, or risk severe and irreversible impacts for people on our ecosystems. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary of State. This is a great opportunity for you and the current administration to integrate all the resiliency measures and sustainability measures and the public policy, taking also into account the new Biden and Harris administration in the United States. So thank you so much for being here and
thank you,
giving your time.
Mr. Albi Ferrer. It's a pleasure.
Thank you. Now we cede the floor to our guest of honor, Dr. Jeffrey Sachs. As you know, he's the director of the SDSN, and whomever hasn't heard much of it will learn a lot today about it. He's been also advocate and special advisor to Antonio Guterres and the past Secretary General also of the United Nations, Ban Ki-moon. He's the leading expert on SDGs and sustainability. And again, we're thrilled to have you in Puerto Rico. I don't know whether you've ever been in Puerto Rico or know.
Of course I have. And welcome. Looking forward to the next time.
The floor is yours, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, colleagues. It's a great honor to be together with you and very exciting because I think the Sustainable Development Goals can really help, can help Puerto Rico, can help the Caribbean region, can help the United States, which God knows needs help, and the whole world. The idea of the Sustainable Development Goals, and it was so nice to see that video. I remember that day very well when the goals were adopted, is to build a better world, a fairer world, and an environmentally survivable and sustainable world. So the basic idea of the Sustainable Development Goals is that we ought to combine economic well-being with social justice and with environmental sustainability. Wouldn't it be nice? That's the idea. And I very much like the fact that the report that motivated the Sustainable Development Goals was by a committee that titled its report, "The Future We Want." The idea is actually to make ourselves agents of building the future that we really want, rather than suffering the facts as they keep spilling out one by one. Well, I think we're in a more optimistic moment right now than we were in the recent past. I won't put anyone else on the line, but I'll say we had a crazy president and a crazy administration, and the United States was at great risk by having Trump, a really nasty man and a dangerous man. And at least we're past that for the moment. But you know, the United States is a tricky country, as we all know, and we're not done with the demons. We're not done with the hatred and the racism and so on, which motivates a lot of Americans and has throughout its history. So we still have a struggle ahead, but we really have a decent president right now. He's a nice man. He's a well-directed man. I've known him for 30 years. He wants to do the right thing, and I'm very excited about that. And we're also meeting on a good day when Congress has passed a good piece of legislation that's going to give help to people that need it, to people who are unemployed, people who are displaced, to state and city governments. If you could believe, Trump hated the cities and he just didn't want to help American cities. But now we have some legislation and some funding also to fight the pandemic. That was another insanity of 2020. If you can imagine, I don't know what it's like in Puerto Rico. I don't know the details, but we have lost 525,000 Americans from COVID. Unbelievable, showing what terrible governance means. It means mass suffering and mass loss of life. Well, the Sustainable Development Goals are the opportunity to do something better. Incidentally, I don't know if President Trump ever said the words Sustainable Development Goals during his whole administration. I don't even know if he said the words separately. I never heard him say sustainable for 4 years. I don't think he ever said the three words in a row. I have spent just about every waking hour on the SDGs since they were adopted, working with the UN and for the UN. To try to help pursue the goals. And we had no support whatsoever. But we do need to help inform the Biden administration about the goals because they need reminding. And they need reminding that this is for all parts of our country and all of the diverse realities that the United States faces. And I think the realities for Puerto Rico are very distinct. And I would like to do anything to help you through our network and through the work that I can do. It happens a little bit by coincidence that I was actually asked by the governments in and the UN country teams in the Pacific Island states to work on the vulnerability of the small island developing states just recently. I'm going to be working with the SIDS group in the UN to produce a multidimensional vulnerability index. We've just been discussing that in the last few days, but most of the countries on that list are your neighbors. And a lot of the problem is the problem of the Caribbean region, which as the Secretary of State has just reminded, is incredibly vulnerable to the climate change taking place and many other related problems. And Secretary of State, I wouldn't say that it was not mainly your responsibility. Puerto Rico created none of this problem. It's pure victim of this problem. This is, you know, mainland industry, which has been the main contributor. Puerto Rico, last time I checked, is not a main oil, gas, or coal producer. So I don't think you had anything to do with this, but you are absolutely in the front line of the damage. And Hurricane Maria and Hurricane Irma and Hurricane Dorian and, you know, the Caribbean is getting smashed by this. And where is the help? Where's the recognition? Where are the investments for resilience and for adaptation, which are essential? These storms are going to come with I'm sad to say it, but they are going to come with increasing intensity and increasing frequency. The sea level is rising. The pressures that are going to come from this are absolutely real. And it is not free to do this adaptation. And Puerto Rico needs help. The Caribbean needs help. We need to have really a much more sensible regional policy, because the shocks are getting worse, though with ingenuity, the safety can still improve. People's lives can be saved. Structures can be made more secure. Readiness can be increased. Protection can be made against flooding and other kinds of damage. And it happens that, luckily, I'm honored, it started way in the Pacific Ocean, but it involves all of the SIDS, this study. So the first thing I'd like to say to all my academic colleagues, I hope we can work together on this, because I think that the chance to view the Caribbean from the SDG perspective is really a valuable and interesting opportunity. And of course, I also work with University of West Indies and with a lot of colleagues at UWI. And I think that there are some real opportunities for collaboration on this. But the point is, we also now have a government that can hear these things, that can listen, that can respond to something sensible. Honestly, it was impossible for the last 4 years, just sheer nastiness. And if anyone pointed out vulnerabilities, he would put the pain in even higher, I'm afraid. But now we have a chance, and we should use this opportunity to say that Puerto Rico has the following challenges on the Sustainable Development Goals. And there are several. It's not only climate change. It is on many of the goals, and with a clear accounting of what the SDGs show, where the gaps are, where progress should be made and can be made, I think we can get a good hearing on this right now and actually make some very practical proposals for Puerto Rico, but I would say more generally, we need help throughout the Caribbean region because it is a regional crisis and some regional opportunities also, and a regional economy that has a lot of shared interest in protecting tourism, protecting safety, and building an infrastructure that is suitable for the realities of the 21st century. The SDSN, let me describe to you briefly, when the first idea of having sustainable development goals was raised back in 2012 at the what was then the 20th anniversary of the Rio Earth Summit. And it was back in Rio that the group met. And actually the Colombian government was the one that recommended having sustainable development goals. I immediately said, that is a great idea, because I was working on the MDGs and the SDGs would just change one letter. So I thought that was very clever and convenient that we could go from MDGs to SDGs seamlessly. And as soon as that happened, I spoke with the Secretary General Ban Ki-moon about the need to mobilize universities as part of the response to get our scientific knowledge, our engineering schools, our public policy schools, law schools, public health institutions, and so on, working on these goals. And so Secretary General created this network, the Sustainable Development Solutions Network. We have now about 1,400 universities around the world working together on the Sustainable Development Goals. And we need very strong role of Puerto Rican universities in this. And you have my full support to do that. So I would love to have that engagement. What the universities are doing is upgrading their teaching programs so that they're teaching sustainable development, which is a really interesting thing to teach because it's not any one discipline. It's problem solving about energy systems, about climate, about public health, about fighting poverty, creating good jobs, social protection. So it's really a cross-disciplinary education, which I find very, very interesting. I don't know much about anything anymore, but I know a little bit about a lot. So that I think is an interesting approach anyway. And the universities are working very much with governments in different parts of the world to help formulate detailed plans, for example, for the energy transformation. And I've been on calls much of the day about the European Green Deal and European universities working with Brussels on their transformation, Chinese universities working with the Chinese government on China's energy transformation, Pakistani universities I was with working on Pakistan's SDG transformation. But this is a second major part is the research agenda and the work with governments to really formulate strong policies. And a third part is the work of universities to support the business sector, because all businesses really need to transform also. We're going to have different energy systems. We're going to have electric vehicles. We're going to have 5G digital services, and businesses are going to be a huge part of that transformation. And universities can train the future workforce, but also they can work with industry on technological changes that are aligned with sustainability. So this is another area. And I find it very rewarding and very promising, and believe, if I might say, that I think that partnerships of universities, business, and government are really important right now, because nobody knows how to do what we need to do. This is something different, and it's not normal politics. It's not what our departments in government necessarily know by themselves. Academics, by the way, know a lot, but they're often very impractical. So it's very good to get the academic side engaged in the real problem solving, where the Secretary of State can explain, look, this is the real problem we face right now, and help us solve the real problem, not the journal article problem, but the real academic, the real life problem that we face. And of course, business really needs skilled labor and skilled workers to be able to be on top of these changes. Time is pretty urgent. I don't think I would have to convince anyone in Puerto Rico about that. We're very late in the day to adjust to these changes. It is incredible how long one can waste time, by the way. It's stunning. We just wasted 4 years in the United States with a nut case administration and going completely in the wrong direction and making enemies everywhere in the world. And now we're trying to catch up for lost time and lost ground. But remember, 2020 set a record for the warmest year on record, actually tied with 2016. But 2016 was an El Nino year, and 2020 was a La Nina year, which is supposed to be cooler, but they came out the same. And that's frightening, because if you adjust for the state of the ocean, definitely 2020 was the hottest year in history. And I have a colleague, by the way, one of the world's greatest, he's probably the world's greatest climate scientist, James Hansen, who's a very famous climate scientist, who I hate to tell you, but he scares the wits out of me. He's a very soft-spoken, lovely man from Iowa, just a Midwesterner in the U.S., as decent and soft-spoken as can be. But he always tells me the situation's even worse than we know. You know, the changes taking place in the Earth's systems, in the Southern Ocean, in the ocean circulation, which we know now is really slowing dangerously, in the increased intensity of storms and so forth, is happening faster at an accelerated rate. So all of this is to say we have our work cut out for us. I love the question, have I been in Puerto Rico? And the answer is, of course I have, several times, but not recently enough. So let's work together. And it would be fantastic to work on these challenges together. They're big, but they're really crucial. And final point that I'll say, young people want to work on these issues. Students want to work on these issues. They want to be empowered to learn, to understand, to help change things. And that is extremely gratifying for us in academia. Our students are pulling us as fast as possible into this kind of problem solving. So I think we have all gears and signals pointing in the direction for moving ahead now. And please count on me. And thank you for letting me join you today. Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much, Professor Sachs. I think the message is loud and clear. And we have members of the private sector here. We have members of universities. Obviously, this is an academic setting right now. And we have members of the public sector. And the challenge really is, how do we work together and act together, along these goals? Now we are going to take advantage, sir, of your minutes here. I believe you have until about, you have like 20 minutes or so, yeah. 25 minutes or so, to have somewhat of a structured session here, because we want to have opportunities for each university to ask you a question, wonderful, make you a comment, and you can, respond back. And we're going to go in alphabetical order. We're going to get started with Universidad Albizu, Dr. Jose Ponce Madera, please.
Sorry, I was on mute. Good evening, Dr. Sachs. Thank you for sharing with us your insights and your perspective. My question is very simple. Could you talk to us a little bit about the last part of what you said about the reaction of students in terms of academia? What approaches are being used? Are these in the universities where it's being implemented, is this like curricular infusion? Because this goes throughout the whole thing. I mean, we're talking about biological aspects, social aspects, ethics, moral. I mean, I could see actually what came to my mind in reading the document is the characteristic of the educated person, which is something that university presidents struggles all the time, because when we come up with a list, it gets outdated, and we have to move to how to update that. And I may say that I see a huge link between what is an educated person and what would be someone who is educated in understanding the sustainable goal, a development goals. I mean, that's my reaction to you. I see one thing, and please let me know how this is implemented.
Fantastic. I think that there are several issues, and I see it the same way as you do. And maybe I'll put it in terms of my own experience. I led a project at Columbia University for 14 years called the Earth Institute, which was an initiative by the university to try to grapple with problems like climate change and other environmental threats. And though I'm an economist, they brought me into this scientist's unit, and I had a chance to emphasize the concepts of sustainable development in this context. So what I learned from this is that first, if you get the students and the faculty around problem solving, it could be the problems of the energy transition. It could be the problems of climate change in the Caribbean or the ecological changes that are underway in the Caribbean, or it could be social challenges. But array the students and the faculty around the problems and say all the different disciplines have a role to play in this. So you need the climatologists to explain the basic dynamics. You need the engineers, because the climatologists are not engineers. They can identify the problem, but they can't solve it. The engineers can generally solve the problem, but they can't turn it into public policy. You need some economists and political scientists to say, okay, now I understand what we need to do, but here's how you can do it, fitting into the budgetary process, the political process, and so forth. You need the psychologists, social psychologists, to explain, here is why Donald Trump doesn't get it, or whatever the question is, or here is how to get an educated public around this. And I really like what you said. I'm spending a lot of time with ethics right now. I spend a lot of time at the Vatican, actually, in the Pontifical Academy of Sciences and the Pontifical Academy of Social Sciences, because the Pope has issued phenomenal encyclicals that are so interesting, Laudato Si and Fratelli Tutti, his two great encyclicals. One is about how to address climate change from an ethical point of view. And Fratelli Tutti, his new encyclical, is about how to work together across ethnic, racial, geographical lines. And it's a wonderful document, by the way, really something very special. But if you don't teach ethics, it's also hard to get this engagement. And I can tell you, I have a PhD in economics. I did not have one day of formal ethics education in undergraduate or graduate. Of course, I had something, but it was not proper education. So some decades later, I'm spending a lot of time with philosophers and a lot of time with moral philosophy. And I kind of wish someone had banged it into me 40 years ago.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Sachs. I think the challenges we're facing also in universities is integrating knowledge, no? And how to break the silos of the scientific thinking divorced from the religious thinking or ethical thinking.
Absolutely.
Let's go to American University, Licenciado Juan Nazario, please, Esquire.
Yes, good evening, Dr. Sachs. Thanks for the time you're spending with us and all your knowledge. I would say that you almost answered the question that I had, but let me tell you, here in the institution, we started working last year regarding the Sustainable Development Goals. And we've done several things, but as you may know, many things has been postponed for the next fall because of the challenges that we've been facing. But I can let you know that the young people, our students, they're very eager to start working with this. We have had some opportunities to meet with them, to exchange our views in this matter. And they're very aware of what's going on because what they have faced here in Puerto Rico because of the natural disasters and what we're facing with the COVID-19. And also they're very aware of what was happening in the mainland because of CNN, right? Yeah, so yeah, you yeah, mentioned yeah. the last 4 years, and it was a learning experience for everyone. So we're very excited because we know that they understand that there are big challenges ahead, yep. but also great opportunities. And as professionals, as entrepreneurs, but also as citizens of the world. And they're young, most of us, I hope that we all have many years to spend together and talk about this, but their perspective is as a young generation. And they're very worried, they're very concerned, but they are committed, and so are we. So I would like to have the opportunity to meet with you and work in this area in the near future. Again, thank you, and you have all our support.
No, it's you have my support, and I think it would be great if we could get together, get students from all of the universities to get together on a Zoom. And we could have a good discussion about the future of Puerto Rico, the future of the United States, mm-hmm. the future of the Caribbean region, talk about regional policy and areas of interest. I'd love that, by the way. It would be wonderful to do. And I think we could listen well to the perspectives of the students and things that they feel they really need for empowerment.
Yes.
But what I find is, you know, having the students take on a challenge or look to the development challenge of Puerto Rico or look to the question of the Caribbean and in an era of global warming and worsening hurricanes and what do we do and what are some of the best approaches and what scientific research can be done and so on, we would find a lot of energy. A lot of really bright, obviously very bright students, but a lot of very bright ideas. And then one of the things that this network can do is connect the students with faculty from any part of the world. What's happening in another place? What's happening in East Asia with the typhoons? What are good ideas that we can exchange across geographies? And it would be fantastic to do that. It is one of the lessons of COVID is that we've learned how to Zoom well. So we could do that with the students sometime soon.
Thank you, Professor Sachs. Let's go to Universidad Central del Caribe, Dr. Valesca Crespo.
Hi, good evening to everyone. Thank you, Dr. Sachs, for share with us these important areas of knowledge. And I think that your call to action is a responsibility for all of us as educators. And in our case, we prepare healthcare professionals, especially MDs. And for my students, has been very interesting starting the conversation about health disparities and how the health disparities are directly related with the economical status of the population, but also the political status of Puerto Rico.
Yep.
I think that we have the perfect scenario right now to continue that type of discussions in Puerto Rico, trying to get some solutions, some answers, not only keeping the conversations, but I think that it's time to establish the goals to fix some of our situations and establish what outcomes we want to get as society. And that needs to be an essential part of our curriculums and in all levels of education, from K to 12, and then in higher ed at different levels, because it matters to all of us as society.
Fantastic.
And I will be more than thrilled to collaborate with you. I continue collaborations with my other colleagues in Puerto Rico.
I would love to do this. Good friends and colleague with the new head of the Centers for Disease Control in Atlanta. And we ought to get CDC engaged at looking at some of the specific challenges of Puerto Rico health, health systems, health disparities as well. So that would be another thing to do. Interestingly, by the way, in the SDSN network, President Wayne Fredrickson of Howard University is a wonderful university leader, very much interested in health disparities. It's one of his areas of expertise. He's also a surgeon, actually. So he's a medical doctor, but I'm engaged with him, and SDSN is engaged with Howard University on the health disparities issue. So if we follow up, I'm sure that we could make a really fruitful connection for areas of study, which I would absolutely love to do. And so count on me for that. And I am sachs@columbia.edu. So very easy, sachs@columbia.edu. And please, anyone feel free to write and to reach out to me, and we'll follow up for sure.
Thank you. Thank you, doctora. Also to remind that Marcela Nunez-Smith, she's from St. Thomas, and she is the co-chair for Biden's COVID response. Marcela, I'm sure she's a Yale professor. I'm sure Jeffrey Sachs knows her.
Yeah, great. Absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. And she's from St. Thomas.
I didn't remember that. So very good.
All right. USVI. All right, going on. I know we're running out of time. Dr. Isaac Esquilin from Huertas College. I don't know that he's here. Forgive me if I... Yes, just moving on then. Licenciado Manuel Fernos from University of Inter-American University. Thank you.
Good evening, Alvin, and greetings to Professor Sachs and to my fellow university presidents. As I listened to you, Dr. Sachs, I was taking some notes, and I thought that maybe we have to address the Sustainable Development Goals topic in two different perspectives. One would be Sustainable Development Goals for the universities themselves, within the universities. Because we have difficult times, so we have to be cost effective, especially because we address middle class students. So we have to try to keep our tuition costs as low as possible so that the Pell Grant would cover all tuition expenses. So that's a challenge. Then we have to preserve quality of academic programs. And And so when you have to combine those two different challenges, the only way to do it is with great imagination, being very effective, right-sizing the university. But when I speak of quality education, I'm not talking only about quality of knowledge, the knowledge being taught. Oh, this is my cost-effective.
Yeah, very good.
Very good.
Energy efficiency.
But not on purpose. But we also teach ethics. Ethics is a course required for all different curriculums in Inter-American University. So, and then you have the issue within the university of resiliency. As you mentioned, we have had hurricanes, earthquakes, pandemic now, and we have to respond to all of those. And government, I must say, federal government was quite slow with this. So we have to work with our insurances to repair, prevent damages on the before the hurricanes. And then we have to repair after the hurricane and do it fast so that we could go back as fast as possible to for an opening, reopening the university for the students. Then the pandemic, we even though in the case of Inter-American, we had prior to the pandemic, 67 online asynchronic courses. So we had quite an experience on this.
Wow.
But we have over 200 on-site courses, academic programs. We have within 2 weeks to move them to synchronic online teaching. Now we have learned a lot in a short time. And universities will not be the same after the COVID-19. The way we teach has changed. Students, many of them now prefer online teaching. So this is changing times. Then the second area, the second perspective, I would say is the role of the universities in helping Puerto Rico develop goals, sustainable development goals. That's a responsibility we have. And then I might say that we have to, in the case of Inter-American, though I know all the universities in Puerto Rico have done the same. We have a strategic plan, a 4-year plan. Every year we renew the plan, we update the plan. Now we have included there the concept, not which academic programs are high demand in the market. No. The question we are answering is what knowledge, what expertise, what capacity our graduates need to have so that they will develop a new Puerto Rico. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
That's
fantastic.
That's considering, of course, the development of Puerto Rico and sustainable development of Puerto Rico. Now, one issue we have here is that's our vision of Puerto Rico. Now, my question is, do we have a common vision for Puerto Rico? The private sector, the government sector? Do we share a common vision for Puerto Rico? The answer is no.
But the SDGs can provide that answer.
I think so. We have to work on that.
Let's go to the answers. Thank you, Licenciado.
Are gone, so.
Yeah, let me thank you very much. Sorry. Let me give you just a quick reaction. First of all, I think, yes, we will have new kinds of education and new kinds of universities. We just did a survey among my staff in SDSN, when do you want to come back to the office? And the answer was never. You know, people are really getting used to working at a distance. They will come in a day a week maybe, but we're really going to change how we work and how we teach. The online can be very effective actually for a lot of the teaching. Obviously, you know, and you're doing it. It can also save a lot of money, actually, both for the students and so on. But we have to figure all of this out. And I think it's an extremely interesting time for us as universities to do that. Let me mention one other basic point, which is obvious, but I think important. The universities in Puerto Rico need to play a unique role within the U.S. academia in understanding the Caribbean, obviously. No one but people living in the Caribbean can understand the Caribbean challenges, the realities, the history, the ecology, the climate risks, and all the rest. And so there's a special role of universities in general in understanding the local context and the regional context. And you know how ignorant of geography mainland America is. Unbelievable, actually, unbelievable. But it means that we really need your leadership, both for, of course, Puerto Rico's own future, this goes without saying, but also for the regional understanding, for the regional ecology, what to do about hurricane risk, what to do on all the other topics that we're talking about. No one but you can figure this out. This is for sure. It can never come from Washington. It can never come from outside. No one cares enough to figure it out, frankly. And so in this sense, the intellectual leadership that the universities can provide is uniquely important for this challenge. And I think it's just very exciting, to have that leadership. And it's like we've all been saying, it's what the students also want and what they need for their empowerment. So thank you very much. Great observations.
Thank you, Professor Sachs. We have three more institutions, sir. Can you spare a few more minutes?
Sorry that I talk so long. I have a hard stop at 6:12. my time. So in 8 minutes.
Okay. All right. We'll make sure that we get as many people as we can in. From the Catholic University of Puerto Rico, Señor Jorge Vélez, Mr. Jorge Vélez Arroyo. Jorge Vélez Arroyo, you're mute.
Yes, go ahead. In your recent book, The Ages of Globalization, Geography, Technology, and Institutions, you emphasize the need for new methods of international governance and cooperation to prevent conflicts and to achieve economic, social, and environmental objectives aligned with sustainable development. At the local level in Puerto Rico, I think that we have a similar challenge, which is to achieve higher objectives of sustainable development. And the challenge is how to establish new methods of institutional and regional governance and cooperation to prevent conflicts. How we do that with our universities? We have the universities. But each, even though we have some instances of cooperation, I think that to reach the sustainable development goals in Puerto Rico, we have to create, as you mentioned in your book, new methods to govern our efforts in terms of sustainable development. And I think that's a challenge for our island, and I think it is a challenge for our universities.
Count on me to help if I can. I realized after 40 years of being an economist, we have a strange idea which we call perfect competition. That's the ideal of a market economy. But why don't we have a concept of perfect cooperation instead of perfect competition? we don't even have that concept. So we need improved cooperation. That's what Pope Francis is emphasizing in Fratelli Tutti, by the way.
Yes,
and we really need this also in the Caribbean region. There's so much insecurity and so much divisiveness, but one region, And I think this is also an opportunity at the regional level that is extremely important.
Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Sachs. We're going now to University of Puerto Rico, Dr. Jorge Haddock.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Sachs, for the for this interesting opportunity, and thank you for sharing all the knowledge and experience you have. I think that you really obviously presented most of the most important aspects of these 17 initiatives. So I like to frame this in a very ambitious question so I can cover as many as possible. Because I was leaning towards the partnerships, because here you have some of the most important academic leaders on the island and certainly some of the most impactful government and industry leaders. So I really leaning towards what are the best practices that you found in creating these partnerships. But in my ambitious question, I like to go back in the late 70s and 80s when I was working in my PhD dissertation. It was on energy planning. And frankly, 40 years later, you see that the cost alternatives haven't changed much. I mean, we've made progress on energy, solar energy and wind, but not really that much for 40 years. It's four decades. So I think that if we project this to the future, what I'm thinking is that it can be a cost-effective solution. And you mentioned ethics, you mentioned the moral dilemma. So how can we really address it? And I mean, I'm talking about energy as an example, but it applies to virtually all of them. I mean, I'm an engineer, but well, I've also been a business school dean. And you can talk about the cost effectiveness or the cost impact on virtually any of the 17. I mean, how can working towards the 17, most of those 17 is also going to be beneficial financially and economically for any country in the world. But it can be cost. It has to be a moral dilemma question that we pose ourselves. So in my ambitious question would be, how can we partner up to really make both arguments in a way that we can really move the needle and say, how can we, for the people that think it has to be cost-effective solution, we use some of those arguments, but for really the strongest arguments have to be, this is a moral dilemma that we're facing and that we have to leave a legacy for future generations.
Wonderful. I think there are two quick points that I would raise to a complicated big issue. One is I would recommend for Puerto Rico, and I would be happy to help on this, that there should be maybe a 1 or 2 day conference on sustainable development for Puerto Rico's future that is multi-sector. And that goes through a number of the key challenges, whether it is education, jobs, health, energy system, resiliency, and so on. And that it is government, academia, and business and civil society in a kind of national forum. And this could be, you know, planned for 3 to 6 months from now. But a real opportunity to put the goals there and then to have a national discussion around them that is all the stakeholders. Academia can be the host of this kind of thing and help to organize it. I have found that to be very effective. It generates lots of discussion. It generates lots of disagreement. But one finds out where the shared vision is and where the differences are. A second point that I would say is energy planning, for example, is crucially important right now. Here we're going to have President Biden say we're going to decarbonize by 2050. The power generation is supposed to be decarbonized by 2035 compared to on the campaign basis, and he's going to unveil draft legislation soon. This is a planning problem. What are the alternative costs? What kind of solutions? Is this something that Puerto Rico does on its own? Is it something that is Caribbean wide? Is it, can you think of a regional grid in across the islands? Does that make sense? Offshore wind? What are the real opportunities here? What can be done in photovoltaics? What can be done in mini hydro? What can be done in wind onshore, offshore, and so on? Great problem for students to work on, by the way. I'm doing a lot of scenario analysis that really is energy planning scenarios. We have a project called Deep Decarbonization Pathways. We did a US analysis, a broad US analysis, called the Zero Carbon Action Plan out of the SDSN that we delivered to the Biden administration. But thinking about doing such a plan for the Caribbean and for Puerto Rico, and asking, so what are the right options given costs, given technology options? If we're really going to decarbonize, how could this be done? I think is a very valid point. And then, as I was emphasizing earlier, Puerto Rico and the neighbors have a lot of adaptation costs ahead. And that really needs to be paid for from outside because it's expensive. But these risks are not Puerto Rico's fault. They are the fault of global climate change, of which Puerto Rico is suffering consequences right now. And I know just for New York City, the project is a minimum of $20 billion to control flooding in New York City after Hurricane Sandy. And they're, you know, they've debated now almost 10 years who's going to pick up the bill. But you can imagine we need to do that kind of scenario building for resiliency and adaptation. And again, I would like to see a Caribbean-wide analysis because the whole region is getting hit again and again and again. And we need a solution that is region-wide.
Thank you, Professor Sachs, for your time.
Yeah, fortunately, I have a call coming in about 30 seconds. I apologize to those who did not answer because I speak too long. But I hope, if I could just say in closing, that we can follow up. It's really great to be with you. I'm very excited. You have a tremendous group of universities and university leaders, and it would be a great pleasure for me to help as a follow-up. So I would look forward to that.
Thank you. Will do. Will do. You have a good day.
Wonderful.
Thank you for your time.
Thanks to everybody. Great. Thanks a lot.
Take care. Bien, muchísimas gracias a todas y a todos por participar. Le vamos a dar la oportunidad a la Universidad del Sagrado Corazón para que nos comente lo que quisiera el presidente Marsuach compartir y luego pasaremos a la presentación y al final de la actividad. Así que adelante, Gilberto. No se oye, Gilberto, por alguna razón. Estás en mute.
En mute.
Sí, ahora.
Yeah. Gracias, Luis Alberto. Gracias a ti, a GFR y a UNA USA por organizar esta actividad, ¿verdad? Nada, un comentario breve, Albi, escuchando las palabras del Dr. Sachs y de mis colegas presidentes universitarios, ¿verdad? O sea, los retos que tenemos en Puerto Rico, ¿verdad? Que requieren investigación, requieren desarrollo de política pública coordinada, requiere desarrollo de iniciativas concretas para atender muchos de los retos de los objetivos de desarrollo mundial, ¿verdad? Y la pregunta es, ¿cómo las universidades podríamos trabajar en conjunto, ¿verdad? Para atender muchos de estos temas, ¿verdad? Yo creo que el Dr. Sachs planteó el tema de colaboración sector público, sector privado, sector universitario. Me parece que para enfrentar estos temas que son multidisciplinarios y multisectoriales, ¿verdad? Necesitamos tener formas de colaboración transsectorial, ¿verdad? Y es un reto que hemos identificado en Puerto Rico a través de mucho tiempo, ¿verdad? Pero creo que es una pregunta urgente. Y me parece que las universidades, tanto la Universidad del Estado como las universidades públicas, ¿verdad? Que somos entidades al servicio público, tal vez podemos tener un rol de marcar unas rutas de colaboración entre nosotros para abrir el camino para atender estos temas. Necesitamos coordinar estrategias de investigación, necesitamos coordinar estrategias de política pública, necesitamos coordinar estrategias de desarrollo de iniciativas. Y me parece que en aglutinar esfuerzos pueden haber oportunidades de sinergia y de efectividad que si actuamos por separado. Así que es un comentario que comparto, ¿verdad? Que me parece que complementa bien lo que mis colegas presidentes y presidentas han comentado en la noche de hoy.
Y yo creo que apunta hacia el diálogo que vamos a tener, ¿no?, al cierre de la tarde. Así que muchísimas gracias, Gilberto. Vamos a pasar entonces a la presentación de Ricardo Arzuaga y luego retomamos. Muchísimas gracias por sus preguntas. He tomado notas y creo que podemos tener una buena, un excelente cierre.
Está en mute, Ricardo.
Muchísimas gracias, Luis Alberto. Muchas gracias por esta primera parte de la actividad. Ahora voy a estar presentándoles por espacio de 10 minutos un poquito de contexto también para abonar a la discusión del restante de la actividad, sobre qué colaboraciones ya se han dado. Precisamente presidente Marzuach estaba hablando de la importancia de las colaboraciones, no solamente entre universidades, sino diferentes sectores. O sea que voy a estar destacando algunas de esas colaboraciones que hemos forjado de 2016 al 2020 y cómo estas colaboraciones han de ayudarnos a propulsarnos en esta década de acción de 2021 a 2030. Comienzo destacándoles que esto comenzó en el 2015 con el 70 aniversario de la Organización de Naciones Unidas y nuestra matriz, United Nations Association of the United States, que es un programa de la Fundación de Naciones Unidas, pues nos habló y nos exhortó a establecer un proyecto especial en Puerto Rico para promover estos objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. Comenzamos una actividad donde estuvo Lecna Pérez de la Fundación de Naciones Unidas, ante más de 500 estudiantes, maestros. Esto fue en la Universidad de Puerto Rico en Calley, o sea que un shout out al doctor Haddock. Rompimos récord de asistencia ese día, así me comentaron los técnicos, nunca habían tenido un teatro de Calley completamente lleno y miren los estudiantes sentados en el piso al frente. Precisamente aquí comenzamos a forjar colaboraciones con el Departamento de Educación, colaboraciones con el Departamento del Interior, el National Park Service, para ver cómo comenzábamos a dar a conocer estos objetivos de desarrollo sostenible en diferentes sectores. Este fue el comunicado de prensa que se generó sobre este proyecto especial por el aniversario de Naciones Unidas. Y luego de eso, pues todos nos acordamos que en el 2017 enfrentamos gran adversidad, pero esta adversidad nos motivó, nos propulsó a ponerle aún más empeño a esto y estamos muy agradecidos a UNAUSA que nos ayudó precisamente a continuar este proyecto en Puerto Rico. Y esto fue a través de una actividad de Giving Tuesday que hicieron para ayudarnos a continuar el proyecto y precisamente hicimos una actividad sobre el Acuerdo de París, sobre cambio climático. Esto fue el 9 de diciembre de 2017, o sea que apenas unos meses, menos de 3 meses luego de los huracanes. Lo hicimos con generadores de FEMA en CROEC, en el Centro Residencial de Oportunidades Educativas en Ceiba. Y básicamente fue una excelente actividad donde los estudiantes tuvieron la oportunidad no solamente de hablar del Acuerdo de París sobre cambio climático, sino también desahogarse un poco y dar su perspectiva sobre cómo Puerto Rico puede ayudar en el tópico de acción climática. Algo interesante que pasó y UNAUSA fue quien nos conectó, fue precisamente un pedido que recibimos del portavoz del secretario general de Naciones Unidas. Él se llama Stefan Dujarric y Stefan nos escribe un correo electrónico donde nos deja saber que su hijo de quinto grado en el Collegiate School de Nueva York quería donar un dinero a Puerto Rico y hizo una recaudación de fondos con sus colegas estudiantes de quinto grado, y querían que esos $600 que recaudaran fueran directamente a escuelas en Puerto Rico que lo necesitaran para adelantar estos objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. Nosotros, nuestra recomendación fue precisamente que este apoyo fuera dirigido a dos escuelas del Departamento de Educación de Puerto Rico, la escuela de Ceiba que les mencioné, pero también la Pedro Rivera Molina de Juncos, los cuales estaban empezando los primeros proyectos de project-based learning o aprendizaje basado en acción sobre los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. Y ellos nos solicitaron que les gustaría pues tener banderas de Naciones Unidas, tener banners de los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible, algo que les ayudara a ellos en promoverlos en sus escuelas. Y aquí les enseño alguna foto. Estos son los estudiantes de CROEC, donde recibieron estos iconos de los ODS y estos banners. También pues los estudiantes en la Pedro Rivera Molina, esto es una maestra de inglés que solicitó que los materiales se le proveyeran en inglés. Y ven a los estudiantes aquí con sus diferentes iconos de los ODS, y también firmaron una bandera para agradecer a Julian Dujarric por esta aportación que les hiciera. Usando esta historia como inspiración y pendiente para asistir a otros colegios de K a 12 en Puerto Rico que puedan integrar los ODS, vamos a estar colaborando bien de cerca con el Sustainable Development Solutions Network, precisamente de profesor Sachs, y un programa que han desarrollado que se llama el Global Schools Program. Hay miles de colegios que están precisamente integrando este programa, y este es el tipo de acciones concretas que podamos hacer en Puerto Rico para integrar, como sugirieron ustedes mismos en el panel y como sugirió el profesor Sachs, cómo podemos envolver a la educación K a 12 con todo esto hacia la década de acción de 2021 a 2030. Este es el logo del Global Schools Program, y verdaderamente tienen una variedad de publicaciones de lecciones para el salón de clase en español por el doctor Fernando Reimers de Harvard College, que son excelentes para aplicarlas en Puerto Rico. También estamos trabajando con diferentes facultades de educación con el fin de desarrollar contenido totalmente pertinente para Puerto Rico y con estadísticas relacionadas con Puerto Rico, para que los estudiantes empiecen a bregar con estos problemas y a ir plantando esa semilla en la mente de nuevas generaciones de estudiantes sobre la importancia de la sostenibilidad y los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible en general. Otra importante iniciativa para avanzar los objetivos de desarrollo en Puerto Rico era unir precisamente a las partes interesadas. Y eso entiéndase pues gobierno, el sector privado, la academia, la sociedad civil, en un sistema colaborativo que le hemos llamado el Grupo de Trabajo de los ODS en Puerto Rico. Este es el logo que se ha creado para este grupo. Actualmente está compuesto por más de 70 organizaciones y más de 180 personas, seres humanos, que son los colaboradores o representantes de estas organizaciones en este ecosistema de colaboración. Voy a estar enfocando el resto de mi presentación en los componentes principales o en la función principal de este grupo de trabajo, que es promover, integrar, avanzar, medir y financiar estos objetivos de desarrollo sostenible en Puerto Rico. Empezamos, y el primer test de este grupo de trabajo fue precisamente la visita en Puerto Rico de una expedición científica apoyado por el gobierno de España, el cual llegó a Puerto Rico en enero 2020. Muchos de ustedes no escucharon esto porque estábamos en el medio de terremotos, como ustedes recordarán y como hicieron hincapié en sus presentaciones. Este fue el comunicado de prensa cuando el velero Acuarela de la expedición Oceania llegó a Puerto Rico. Ahí les tengo que destacar algunos de los colaboradores en este grupo de trabajo, comenzando con Para la Naturaleza, que fue el coanfitrión de esta expedición, pero también al Servicio Forestal, a Puerto Rico al Sur, Custom and Border Protection, local guests, el Consulado de España en Puerto Rico, San Juan Bay Marina, Bombazo Dance Company. Eso es colaboración y las colaboraciones no son fáciles. Es importante que la gente se conozca y esto fue un excelente ejercicio que hicimos en Puerto Rico para recibir estos científicos en Puerto Rico. Estos son algunos de los jóvenes que estaban en la conferencia de prensa en San Juan Bay Marina. Y luego fuimos directamente, ahí viene la bandera de España del catamarán, una foto grupal previo a visitar el proyecto TRACE, que es un proyecto sobre el impacto del cambio climático en bosques tropicales. Es el primero, el único en el mundo que está bregando con esta investigación y es parte del Instituto de Taxonomía Tropical. O sea que ahí los estudiantes tuvieron la oportunidad de ver ese proyecto científico en acción y ver precisamente pues, todos los componentes que envuelve. Esto es parte del proyecto metido en nuestro bosque nacional, el Yunque, y por supuesto, tocando dos de los ODS, acción climático y vida en ecosistemas terrestres. Este fue el comunicado que sacó Trace sobre esa visita. Y luego el segundo día fuimos exclusivamente para la naturaleza, nos extendió la cortesía de abrir la Reserva Natural Las Cabezas de San Juan para esta expedición. Ahí se continuó el documental sobre este proyecto con staff de Para la Naturaleza, donde les dejaron saber a todos los participantes lo que estaban haciendo y la importancia de estos ecosistemas en Puerto Rico. Fernando Llovera estuvo con nosotros durante la tarde y fue un excelente día. Este fue el segundo día de la expedición. Luego, al otro día, fuimos a Ponce. Pocos de ustedes, y yo era uno de ellos, desconocen que hay un monumento sobre la abolición de la esclavitud en Ponce, que es el único en el Caribe. Y precisamente ustedes se imaginarán que estábamos precisamente en el medio de los terremotos, pero todo este grupo de ponceños que nos recibieron, a la verdad que nos dejaron saber cómo para ellos fue un stress relief el estar con nosotros esa tarde filmando allá en Ponce con grupos culturales que estuvieron con nosotros. Y los temblores en esta ocasión fueron temblores de cultura que tuvimos allá en Ponce con esta expedición, también dejando saber qué estamos haciendo y la importancia de los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible también en la cultura y también en ese monumento histórico que pocos en Puerto Rico conocemos. Este fue el comunicado de prensa que se desarrolló sobre esta expedición. Y entonces destaco que otro importante componente de promover los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible y de promoverlos localmente fue el desarrollo de dos actividades que vamos a estar llevando a cabo todos los años. La primera es la Semana de los Objetivos de Desarrollo Sostenible en el mes de septiembre. Y la otra, la actividad Meta Global es 100x35 en Casa Bacardi. Ya las hemos llevado en dos ocasiones. Primero, la primera la hicimos en colaboración, una vez más, destacando las colaboraciones, la importancia de estas colaboraciones. Lo hicimos con el Exploratorio, el Museo de Ciencias de Puerto Rico, y preparamos todo un lineup durante toda la semana de presentaciones pertinentes sobre los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. Importante destacar que más de 60,000 personas han visto los videos que se presentaron esa semana. Y es importante destacar cómo esa pandemia, ese Zoom connection que nos hablaba el profesor Sachs, que ahora todos somos expertos o por lo menos no estamos reacios a utilizar la tecnología, cómo también nos puede ayudar en esta gran gesta de dar a conocer los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible en Puerto Rico. Este es el banner en Casa Bacardí. Estamos colaborando con la compañía porque es una compañía que está bien envuelta, bien comprometida con los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible alrededor del mundo y tiene un gran impacto en Puerto Rico, una gran huella. Aquí está la destilería de ron más grande de nuestro planeta. O sea que era importante para nosotros empezar esas colaboraciones con el sector privado y que nos ayudaran en promover estos ODS en Puerto Rico. Como estábamos destacando en la presentación de Sachs, los estudiantes de ustedes en las universidades están locos porque ustedes los apoderen y los ayuden a promover estos objetivos de desarrollo sostenible en Puerto Rico. Y tengo que destacar dos de los miembros del grupo de trabajo, que son grupos de jóvenes Enactus y JCI Puerto Rico, quienes están precisamente, mira lo que Enactus ha hecho recientemente, unos retos con los objetivos, se llaman 17 metas, un propósito, y han hecho un llamado específico para la juventud en Puerto Rico para que se envuelvan en estos diferentes retos relacionados con los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. Pero es como decía el profesor Sachs, más allá de un curso curricular, es acción. Estamos en la década de acción de 2021 a 2030, o sea que dejarles saber, y sigo, que no están solos en esta gesta en Puerto Rico, que ya se han dado unos pasos importantes y que lo importante ahora es continuarlos. JCI Puerto Rico pues creó su propia academia sobre los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible, y no solamente en Puerto Rico, han envuelto toda la red de JCI Puerto Rico, de JCI en todas partes del mundo. También, otra cosa importante para la promoción e integración de los ODS en Puerto Rico a través de la educación para desarrollo sostenible, para nosotros va a ser el promover un gran salón natural que tenemos en nuestro bosque nacional, el Yunque, y es el centro de visitantes, el portal en el Yunque, y también el SDG Academy del Sustainable Development Solutions Network. Déjenme dejarles saber, porque ustedes conocen quizás que desde los huracanes se ha puesto en marcha un proyecto para la revitalización del centro de visitantes del portal de Yunque, a casi 20 millones de dólares que se están envolviendo en este proyecto. Y verdaderamente nos honra que US Forest Service es parte del grupo de trabajo, pero que nos invitó desde el SAQUE a la primera visita en campo sobre los diseños y sobre el proceso que se iba a hacer en este portal. Y una de las cosas que nos honra estar colaborando con ellos es insertar un panel sobre los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible, pero también otra cosa que muy pocos puertorriqueños conocen es que nuestro Bosque Nacional del Yunque forma parte del programa del hombre y la biosfera de la UNESCO, Man and the Biosphere Program. O sea que eso es algo que se va a destacar también en ese panel, y nos honra ser parte del mismo. Y como estaba mencionando ahorita, él no tuvo la oportunidad de destacar que el Sustainable Development Solutions Network ha desarrollado una gran universidad global, que toda la facultad de ustedes y ustedes mismos pueden entrar, y es precisamente Free Open Educational Sources de los más grandes expertos en el planeta en desarrollo sostenible. Importante destacar también que una de las publicaciones disponibles es el Laudato Si, que él estaba mencionando, del Papa Francisco. Es uno de los cursos disponibles. O sea que, imagínense, no tenemos que reinventar la rueda para que en Puerto Rico todos conozcamos sobre desarrollo sostenible, y particularmente que nos podamos enfocar en aquellos ODS que nos interesan a nosotros y a su facultad y a sus estudiantes y a ustedes personalmente. También, otra iniciativa importante es cómo integrar el sector privado. Como estaba mencionando Marzuachi y algunos de ustedes durante sus preguntas y comentarios. Y precisamente, pues, dimos los primeros pasos en esta dirección en el 2019 con una colaboración con el Pacto Global de Naciones Unidas. El Pacto Global es la red de negocios de empresas más grande del mundo, con más de 10,000 compañías comprometidas con avanzar los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible en el mundo. Y comenzamos con una actividad por invitación de Invest Puerto Rico y también Álvarez Díaz Villalón, la firma de arquitectos que son parte del Pacto Global de Naciones Unidas, y nos exhortaron a invitar a Adam Gordon, que es la persona que está aquí, a dar una presentación durante ese evento en el Centro de Convenciones en Puerto Rico. Como ven, en su presentación, SDGs for a Post María Puerto Rico, muy pertinente, y precisamente compartió con todos los presentes cómo esto es un gran framework, un gran marco para negocios responsables basado en declaraciones y convenciones de Naciones Unidas, que eso es lo que está detrás de los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. También, otra parte bien importante es financiamiento de estos objetivos de desarrollo sostenible en Puerto Rico. Más allá de la monumental tarea que tiene el honorable Larry Selhammer a través del Consejo de Reconstrucción de Puerto Rico. Pues más allá que eso, hay socios colaboradores en el grupo de trabajo como Kiva, Causa Local y como Filantropía Puerto Rico, que han sido y serán instrumentales en este proceso también de financiamiento. Primero que nada, pues Causa Local está proveyendo acceso a capital a muchas empresas que quieren ser sostenibles desde su creación. Ellos ofrecen préstamos de hasta $15,000 con 0% de interés y lo han hecho a más de 200 empresas en Puerto Rico. Y lo más interesante es que estas empresas, desde que se están creando, ya incorporan los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible porque saben lo que todos nosotros debemos entender claramente, y es que los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible nos ofrecen un lenguaje común, pero también un propósito común que deberíamos todos adoptar en Puerto Rico. Esto no es un proyecto de ninguna organización, esto es un proyecto global. O sea que me llena de honra ver cómo estos negocios ya empiezan e incorporan en sus artes y su mercadeo los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. Estas son las caras de Nuevo Puerto Rico. Estos son los jóvenes que estábamos hablando anteriormente. Mírenlos en la acción, mírenlos cómo crean estas compañías, estas empresas que ya son sostenibles. Y para darles un ejemplo bien claro, déjenme decirles que enviamos unos detalles de agradecimiento al profesor Sachs, precisamente a su casa de Nueva York, y son todos productos sostenibles hechos en Puerto Rico a través de una compañía que se llama Produce. Y Produce, pues yo pude haber ido a diferentes sitios para comprarle ese regalo, ese reconocimiento a Sachs, pero queríamos obviamente que fueran productos sostenibles, y esto es algo que todos los puertorriqueños debemos hacer. Y en el caso de filantropía, es bien importante también cómo nos damos cuenta que la filantropía a nivel global, desde las más grandes organizaciones como Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, muchos de los cuales están interesados en hacer inversiones en el mundo académico, están pidiendo que las propuestas estén alineadas a los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. O sea que agradecimos de gran manera, de sobremanera, esa invitación que nos hiciera Filantropía Puerto Rico. Y by the way, fueron los que nos enviaron también un detalle tan especial de Produce, que nos hicieron a nosotros querer hacer lo propio y continuar apoyando compañías locales sostenibles con productos hechos en Puerto Rico. Finalmente, el avanzar los ODS, tanto en Puerto Rico como en el exterior, nos corresponde a todos. Y estábamos hablando anteriormente, y por eso destaco a Luis Alberto Ferrer, por todos los artículos que ha escrito relacionados con los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible, pero también dejarles saber que hay unas redes, unos networks que es importante que ustedes se unan. O sea que el profesor Sachs no les destacó esto, pero yo aprovecho para así hacerlo. Hasta el momento, la Universidad de Puerto Rico y UNAUS Puerto Rico son los únicos miembros del Sustainable Development Solutions Network que él dirige. Y precisamente su staff me destacó que por favor les dejara saber a ustedes que están abiertas las convocatorias ahora de marzo a junio. O sea que exhorto a cada una de las universidades que se encuentra presente en esta actividad a que se unan a este gran network, a esta gran red global, que como dijo él, está compuesta por 35 hosts nacionales, tiene 12 regionales y casi 1,500 socios alrededor del mundo. Otra red que quizás ustedes desconocían que existe, se creó en Puerto Rico también y fue en enero 2020. Quizás esto se distrajo con toda la atención que merecía lo que estaba pasando en Puerto Rico en ese entonces, pero se firmó aquí en Puerto Rico con siendo un anfitrión, la Fundación Comunitaria en Puerto Rico, se firmó un acuerdo llamado el Climate Strong Island Declaration, lo cual dio paso a una red que se llama el Climate Strong Island Network. Y precisamente recientemente el estuario de la Bahía de San Juan escribió un artículo al respecto de lo importante de la colaboración regional. O sea que nos honra nosotros ser parte del mismo y de todos estos networks que les voy a mencionar ahora, que uno de ellos se creó también en Puerto Rico ya. el Regional Center of Expertise on Education for Sustainable Development, afiliado a la Universidad de Naciones Unidas en Japón, comenzó y fue admitido en enero 2020 y llevamos ya un año trabajando en él. Muchas organizaciones, incluyendo sus universidades, su facultad, son parte de esta nueva red. O sea que es importante, nuevamente les destaco cosas que ya estaban ocurriendo, que desconocía si ustedes sabían, pero este fue el comunicado de prensa que salió sobre el RCE Puerto Rico, el cual nos honra colaborar estrechamente. Y último, pero no de menos importancia, nuestra sociedad reclama acción climática ahora. Este es el más reciente red que se ha creado en Puerto Rico. Más de 400 organizaciones e individuos son parte del mismo y estamos todos en la misma dirección. Estamos hablando el mismo idioma. Queremos acción en todos estos temas y precisamente no están solos en esta gesta. Nuestra más reciente actividad en diciembre 8 del 2020, nuestra actividad, la actividad Global Goals 100x35 en Bacardí, aunque fue virtual en esta ocasión, tuvo como oradoras principales a Celeste Connors de Hawaii Green Growth y a Kate Brown, que es la directora de Global Island Partnership. Y lo importante de esto, y miren las caras que estábamos ahí, pues en ese día muchas de las universidades también participaron en la misma, pero lo importante destacar es que GLISPA y Hawaii Green Growth son parte de la última red que les voy a mencionar, que para nosotros es imprescindible que Puerto Rico, el gobierno de Puerto Rico, se una a ella, y estaremos exhortando al honorable Larry Eisenhower para que sea nuestro representante en la misma, y es precisamente el Local 2030 Island Network, y es precisamente para bregar con lo que estaba mencionando el profesor Sachs, el impacto del cambio climático y de los ODS en general en islas alrededor del mundo. Y es precisamente la primera red global liderada por islas que ha sido generada o fomentada desde Naciones Unidas. Fue anunciada en septiembre de 2019 durante la Asamblea General de Naciones Unidas. Y dos grandes mujeres que están detrás de esta red son Amina Mohamed, que es la Deputy Secretary General de las Naciones Unidas, y mi más alta jefa en la Fundación de Naciones Unidas, la embajadora Elizabeth Cousins, quien es la presidenta y CEO de UN Foundation. Este network en particular, y aquí les culmino mi presentación, tiene cuatro principios, y estos cuatro principios es... Precisamente hubo un llamado sobre alguno de ustedes a identificar metas locales que fueran pertinentes para largo plazo y en búsqueda de ese liderazgo político que se necesita para bregar con este tema. También las alianzas público-privadas que también ustedes mencionaron son primordiales. ¿Y cómo envolvemos a las partes interesadas en la parte de política pública y planificación? Por otra parte, en medir el progreso de los ODS, si nos establecemos unas metas locales, pues debemos también, y eso es uno de los principios, desarrollar unos indicadores que sean local y culturalmente informados o pertinentes. O sea que hay que establecer unas metas locales y cómo medimos el impacto de esas metas globales de 2021 a 2030. Finalmente, busca el implementar iniciativas concretas en el área de la economía circular, pero también soluciones concretas para el área de agua, energía y alimentos. O sea que ahora les doy un vistazo global de la presentación que acabo de dar y cómo vemos la visión de la década de acción en Puerto Rico. Primero, con un gobierno de Puerto Rico envuelto con el Local 2030 Island Network, que estemos activos en educación, Education for Sustainable Development, a través de SDSN, el Global Schools Program, el SDG Academy y ese gran salón natural que vamos a tener en nuestro bosque nacional, el Yunque, todos aprovecharlo. El sector privado lo vamos a estar moviendo hacia el Pacto Global de Naciones Unidas y queremos enfocarnos en buscar un punto medio de que esto no sea relaciones públicas, que esto sea un compromiso genuino de estas compañías, y por eso, como les dije, nos hemos afiliado con Bacardí y tantas otras que han decidido dar los primeros pasos. También las partes interesadas, el ciudadano común, tiene una opción de redes de envolverse, tiene el grupo de trabajo en Puerto Rico, tiene el RCE Puerto Rico, el Climate Strong Island Network y Acción Climática Ahora. Y finalmente tenemos que tener un robusto componente de comunicaciones. Vamos a tener un portal donde vamos a recoger todas estas iniciativas y tenemos que sin duda tener robustas redes sociales también para dar a conocer esto a nivel macro en Puerto Rico. O sea que termino y concluyo agradeciendo a todas las personas del Sustainable Development Solutions Network que hicieron esta actividad posible, el profesor Sachs, Emma Torres, Caroline Fox, Alaina y Giovanni Bruna, el Program Manager. También al honorable Larry Selhammer Rodríguez por acompañarnos en la noche de hoy. Todos los presidentes de universidades nos honran con su presencia y les agradecemos grandemente que hayan asistido a esta actividad y recibir su insumo. También al Grupo Ferrer Rangel, Social Innovation, al Grupo de Trabajo, aquellas compañías que nos ayudan en este proyecto especial en Puerto Rico para, entre otras, lograr este evento que hemos llevado durante la noche de hoy. O sea que les agradezco muchísimo por su atención y le paso nuevamente el micrófono a Luis Alberto.
Gracias, Ricardo. Creo que con la presentación de Ricardo se da una panorámica de cómo esta red de colaboradores se está organizando, y era importante que ustedes como presidente de universidades y presidenta de universidades pudiesen ver que existe esta red y cómo se está organizando por los distintos pilares que al final Ricardo les presentó. Ya estamos rayando casi las 8 de la noche, no quiero abusar del tiempo de ustedes, pero quería solamente aprovechar estos últimos 10 minutos sencillamente para provocar la discusión alrededor del tema de la alianza y el tema de colaboración. Y escuchar de ustedes con respecto a qué ideas, qué sugerencias o qué preguntas tienen con respecto a esta posibilidad. Y tengan en mente cuando las hagamos el interés o no que puedan tener, o la curiosidad que puedan tener con respecto a la, al SD, al Solution Network, ¿no? Al SDSN Network. Debemos tener esta conversación con más calma en otro momento cuando se pueda. Y quizás pues el grupo de UNAUSA nos pueda ayudar a traer algún otro recurso, pero abro el piso para escuchar preguntas o comentarios al respecto a lo que he estado invitando a discutir.
Sí, quisiera comentar que rápidamente,
perdón,
que nosotros recientemente en ACUP, la Asociación de Colegios y Universidades Privadas, trabajamos juntos, o sea, un buen ejemplo de colaboración, una propuesta para un nuevo Puerto Rico 2030. En esto debo destacar que participó el presidente de la Universidad de Puerto Rico también, que se unió a nosotros en la redacción y aprobación de este documento, que usó de referencia algunos documentos de las Naciones Unidas, pero debo decir que no usó el documento de Sustainable Development Goals. No obstante, y tengo el documento aquí conmigo, debo decir que hay algunos elementos de desarrollo sostenible en la propuesta, como es energía renovable, protección del ambiente, calidad de agua para todos. Así que sí hay unos elementos de desarrollo sostenible, pero creo que habría que revisitar el documento de la propuesta para un nuevo Puerto Rico 2030 para incorporar con más precisión esos conceptos, y hago la sugerencia entonces que usemos ese mismo mecanismo de ACUP con la invitación del presidente de la Universidad de Puerto Rico uniéndose, y que podemos trabajar eso en ese foro, porque creo que sí que debemos darle esa atención. Gracias.
Gracias, licenciado. Jorge.
Sí, no, yo le iba a sugerir, ya que planteas, Alvi, de qué tipo de actividad podíamos hacer en el futuro. Yo pensaba, le sugiero que consideren
adquirir el libro de Sachs, este libro del 2020, que se titula The Ages of Globalization, Geography, Technology and Institutions. Porque ese libro hace mucho énfasis en el tema de cómo desarrollar la gobernanza de una red como la que estamos hablando. Y el libro hace énfasis de que es una gobernanza que esté dirigida a que haya cooperación, a que se prevengan los conflictos y que se consigan los métodos de desarrollo sostenible. Así que puede ser una actividad interesante que se consiga el libro, ¿verdad? Lo consigamos y tengamos una noche como la que tú acabas de gestar esta noche para comentar de qué nos presenta Sachs en este libro muy práctico sobre cómo organizarnos. Cómo organizarnos para no solo a nivel local, sino a nivel regional para el Caribe.
Gracias. Interesante. ¿Alguien más quisiera comentar en este punto?
Quería mencionar algo. Un reto que él continuamente nos estaba desarrollando era, y acabo de decir, el presidente de la Católica, es regionalizar o Puerto Rico. Y me viene a la mente, ¿verdad?, que le dediqué mucho tiempo al CBI, que fue impulsado por Reagan. Y una decisión que tenemos que tomar como país, entre muchas, pero es si vamos a ser Puerto Rico vis-a-vis los Estados Unidos nada más, o si vamos a ser Puerto Rico vis-a-vis el Caribe. Y ¿qué es el Caribe y Centroamérica? Eso eran los países. Pero es un reto, una decisión que tenemos que tomar. Yo estuve súper envuelto en eso, con la 936, los fondos 96, el Twin Plants y todo eso. Pero no estoy diciendo que lo debemos hacer, pero es una decisión que tenemos que tomar.
Interesante. Aquí estamos atando ya, hay una plataforma en ACUB, hay una invitación para volver a invitar quizás a los asesores de Sachs, un grupo de trabajo para discutir el libro, discutir la gobernanza. El tema de Puerto Rico y Caribe, Puerto Rico es parte del Caribe, Puerto Rico tiene por milla cuadrada la concentración de universidades más alta en cualquier parte del Caribe, no sé dominicana, pero por lo menos me atrevo a decir que aquí pues que no hay por qué no ser una sede, ¿no?, para el Caribe, para buscar soluciones regionales, que las son las mismas que vamos a buscar en Puerto Rico, solo que es como se pueden escalar. Una de las cosas que más me interesó de Sachs fue también lo que dijo los estudiantes, porque es algo que nosotros hemos vivido, y cómo los estudiantes nos están llevando, ¿no?, hacia acción, investigación y acción, y cómo muchos de ellos se están organizando ya alrededor de estos nódulos, ¿no?, que tienen que ver con los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. Comentarios al respecto, ideas que puedan tener con respecto a la transversalidad de todos ustedes, ¿no? Y estos estudiantes, ¿alguna posibilidad de crear unas alianzas a través de usted, que transcienda, ¿no?, que una a todas las universidades con los estudiantes? Capítulos así de los ODS.
Yo comenzaría con la actividad que Dr. Sachs estaba recomendando de por qué no hacíamos
un congreso,
una reunión, un congreso, algo por Zoom, sí, donde entonces cada uno de nosotros tuviera la asignación de asegurarnos de que promovemos la actividad entre todos nuestros estudiantes y que nuestros estudiantes entonces participen activamente. Yo creo que eso podría ser un buen paso interesante y de ahí seguramente va a salir una agenda de trabajo entre nuestros estudiantes.
Gracias, doctora. Excelente. Posibilidad en otro tema, y vamos a ir ya cerrando ya mismo, posibilidad de compartir entre ustedes lo que se está enseñando con respecto a los objetivos de desarrollo sostenible. compartir currículum, ver los que están enseñando. No sé si eso es una práctica que se hace.
Recientemente, a través de ACUP, nosotros en ACUP decimos que colaboramos en todo, menos que para el reclutamiento de los estudiantes. Ahí somos competitivos, pero en todo lo demás colaboramos. Recientemente estábamos haciendo un inventario de los programas de educación continuada que beneficiaran a los pequeños empresarios. Se está haciendo el inventario de los currículos en cada institución. Así que sí, este tipo de actividad de colaboración es factible hacerla. De hecho, estaba pensando en algo. O sea, yo creo que a veces nosotros revisamos nuestras respectivas misiones. Este sería un buen momento también para nosotros revisar nuestras misiones y ver qué decimos en nuestras misiones y nuestras metas en términos de sostenibilidad. Desarrollo sostenible. Debo decir, además, que hay una cosa que percibo en la juventud, que percibo en nuestros estudiantes. Tienen mucha sensibilidad por la preservación del medio ambiente. Ellos son muy protectores de todo lo que sea el agua, el ambiente, las playas, la naturaleza. Así que ahí hay un campo fértil en nuestra juventud que es cuestión de educarlos, enseñarlos y canalizarlos. Pero yo creo que ellos van a estar muy receptivos a un congreso donde se les invite, se les oriente, que fomentemos las organizaciones, en los decanatos estudiantes, fomentemos las organizaciones estudiantiles que tengan que ver con la preservación del medio ambiente y el desarrollo sostenible. Así que creo que tenemos agenda. Y yo creo que esto se debe poner en la agenda de ACUP y cada uno de nosotros en la individual.
Gracias, licenciado. Yo creo que ha sido un poquito atropellado estos últimos 10 minutos, pero creo que estamos recibiendo la esencia, lo principal de lo que estamos escuchando y hemos aprendido hoy. Obviamente hay una gran oportunidad en la colaboración entre las universidades. Hay una gran oportunidad de colaboración entre la universidad, el sector privado y el sector público. Eso es un monstruo en sí, lo sabemos. Y hay una gran oportunidad también en integrar a los estudiantes, ¿no? Yo creo que están como que esos tres polos ahí. Creo que por ahí va a seguir continuando nuestra conversación. Quiero darle las gracias a todas y a todos por haber estado aquí estas 2 horas y más, porque algunos se conectaron para atender asuntos técnicos así que nos vamos a seguir comunicando con ustedes. El grupo de UNA USA y el grupo Ferrer Rangel, vamos a hacer un debrief a ver cuáles son los próximos pasos, pero realmente véannos a nosotros como facilitadores para crear una agenda en común y más que nada, pues nuevamente muchísimas gracias por haber estado aquí esta noche y que tengan una buena fin de semana.
Muchas gracias por invitarme.
Gracias por la invitación.
Buenas noches.
Buenas noches
a todos.
Buenas noches. Cuídense.
Muchas gracias. Buenas noches, honrados.
Igualmente.
Gracias.